You're listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network, now the largest new media platform on the web, and your number one source for after-show entertainment. Very good, Gene Johnson. AfterBuzz Studios in Los Angeles, California. Presented by Maria Menounos and streaming live thanks to Akamai Technologies. This is AfterBuzz TV's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. After Show. We'll break down tonight's episode and get you all the latest news and gossip. And now, another post-game wrap-up show for your favorite TV show. It's AfterBuzz TV's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. After Show.
Hey, gang, how's it going? You know what time it is. You're here at AfterBuzz TV. It's the Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. After Show. Talking about Season 1, Episode 18, Providence. I am Matt Lieberman. Joining me on the panel is a fantastic and talented Miss Megan Salinas.
Hey, agents.
Kristen Carroll, Joyce Ajuri, couldn't join us this week, but we have some fantastic guests in their place. Dear friend Zach Wilson is here.
Thank you for having me, guys.
Yeah, glad you could be here. We've been wanting to do this for a while. Zach, some of you may know from the Almost Human podcast or the Grimm podcast or the Resurrection podcast. And we also have a fantastic guest. Samantha Cataran is here, who played the role of Corrine on Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Now, you were giving Agent Coulson a massage in fictional Tahiti.
Oh, yeah. We had to rehearse that a couple times, actually, to make sure I got it just right. And you got the pressure just right.
Yeah, you and Clark got very, very personal. We're going to get into all of it. We also are expecting a call, I don't know if it's coming or not, from the lovely Pascal Armand, who played Aquila Amador early in the season. You may have remembered her from the episode I Spy. She was Phil Coulson's protege, who got the clairvoyance eye device up in her brain, and she was an assassin. She really didn't like it, so we'll talk to her all about that. But in the meantime, let's talk about this episode, a great continuation of last week's propulsive installment, as we further explore what's going to happen to our Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. now that S.H.I.E.L.D. is branded a terrorist organization. How do we feel?
It was great.
Yeah.
it kicked the show into high gear in a way that we hadn't seen in the first 16 episodes of the season. They're like, we can't say the H word, so we don't know what exactly. They're just waiting. They're biding their time, and now they're just like, great. Let's do what we wanted to do.
Right. It's not just we're the peacekeepers who protect the world. They now have an active storyline. There is an evil organization, a terrorist organization that was embedded within their own. They're pariahs. They've been erased now from history and from any and all government records. No one's going to know that they exist. And now they have to root out Hydra before they do something dastardly to the entire planet.
Yeah. I love just the social media stuff that S.H.I.E.L.D. has been doing. For the longest time has had the hashtag, or at least for the latter half of this season, has had the hashtag, it's all connected. And we're finally seeing all this stuff that they laid the groundwork for come together. And it's just explosive. And I can't wait until the end of the season.
Yeah, it's so exciting. They've definitely built it up. And I want to keep watching. And I want more. So they're doing an awesome job with the writing. And I'm hooked.
Right? We're just jonesing for another fix. Especially another fix of Evil Ward, who is great.
Yeah, it's disturbing how evil he is. Mm-hmm. Like how easily he just puts on that evil face. I'm like, but I loved you. I was shocked at the end of the last episode. I was like, no, why? I like you. I mean, I still like him.
We all were shocked, but honestly, I just think he has so much personality when he's being evil. Like, he's been playing, like, you know, the gruff, you know, by the books kind of, you know, agent type, and realizing that that was the act. That he's just, you know, he's not a great, that Ward is not the greatest of actors, you know, that he's not being himself and being loose while playing this role. The fact is, he's got a lot of swagger to him. I gotta give it to him. He's got the swagoo. I'm a big fan. Let's get into it. So we open with our old friend Raina, your old friend Raina,
yeah, love
Samantha.
Her.
She's in prison, and Hydra leads a raid on the prison, and Ward comes in bearing a gift from the clairvoyant, a beautiful new flower dress, because that's all Raina wears. And
it's Marvel Universe. Everybody has a costume, whether it's tights or an iron suit.
Or she's got a delightful floral print. Yeah, exactly. Delightful floral print. And so he frees her from prison. And he frees her from prison, and then takes her to this this like Cuban barbershop where Agent Garrett is getting a trim, and it's also the secret Hydra base, I guess, mm-hmm. is underneath this barbershop, which like it's one of those tropes that I've seen before, mm-hmm. and like I'm just like, oh, are we doing this? But it ultimately it didn't matter.
Wasn't it like mm-hmm. Inspector Gadget had?
I don't know if it was Inspector Gadget had under a barbershop. There was an episode of Justice League Unlimited where Lex Luthor had one under a barbershop. An undercover brother, their secret base was under a barbershop.
Right.
Yes. No. There's a long and storied history of folks having secret bases under barbershops.
I didn't know that was a thing.
It's a thing, which is why I'm like, we don't need another barbershop base, but it doesn't matter.
And then they got to chop their heads off so they get two more. Barbershop's a convenient place to
do
it.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, brother. Yeah.
We were all very confused.
Yeah, we were all like, what? fun. So Garrett has a plan. First of all, he reveals that he's not actually clairvoyant to Raina, who's very disappointed.
Mm-hmm.
She really bought into the whole thing.
Yeah, she was a true believer, and you could just see the look on her face when she's like, you're a fraud. Mm-hmm. You're a liar. And just like hurt that was there, too.
Yeah. Now, do any of you think that maybe some folks online, I took a brief look at the Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. subreddit, which honestly, if you're not paying attention to that on show night, it just pops off. A lot of folks over there are asking the question, you know, is she so disillusioned with the clairvoyant and the fact that he's just a man that maybe she'll turn on Hydra and help out our S.H.I.E.L.D. folks?
There's a possibility. I mean, the way they're setting it up, it could go either way at this point. Yeah.
I mean, it's who do you trust on both sides? Mm-hmm. She could easily flip. We don't have enough backstory on the character to mm-hmm. know what her true motivations are. Mm-hmm. She was so overwhelmed with the concept of a psychic, of a clairvoyant who can see everything. I think that sort of took her over. And just the way that like a lot of people have reacted to like the Chitauri invasion and that changing their perspective on reality.
Right.
Now that changed her perspective and mm-hmm. now it was a lie.
Well, mm-hmm. she's someone who has a lot of insight into people. And to be so utterly hoodwinked has got to be discouraging. Mm-hmm. It also seems to me that she places...
We have Pascal on the line.
Oh, we have Pascal. Oh. Pascal, are you with us?
Yes. Hi. How are you?
We're doing very well.
You're live on the air with AfterBuzz TV.
Hi.
Hi.
Hi, Pascal. How are you doing?
I'm good. It's 1:20 in the morning. But I've been waiting for you guys, so here.
Thank you so much for staying up.
Yeah, thank you for joining us.
No problem. My pleasure.
So tell us, I know it's been a minute, but like, tell us about your experiences filming your episode. We really enjoyed watching it.
Oh, thank you. Well, it was great. I had loads of fun. I filmed 10 days in Los Angeles and then went for a weekend to Sweden. So that was really nice. I was in Stockholm.
Mm-hmm.
So that was a lot of fun, you know, and everybody was great on the set. I'm a theatrical actor. So like, you know, being on set, you know, on a big, huge set and, you know, dealing with, you know, these actors who are just, you know, everybody's on TV and everything. I was just kind of like, oh, it's very different, you know, going through the theatrical process of, you know, putting a character together and then, you know, you flip it and you only have the script and a few days. You've got to make like hard choices
right.
and, you know, run with it. So it was different, but it was a great experience. I liked it all around. It was all good.
This role also had a lot of physicality to it. Did you do any... you had a really great fight scene with Ming-Na at one point in the episode. Did you do anything to prepare for that, or did you already sort of have that training?
Well, I mean, I went to NYU, so we had space combat
I did too.
Classes.
Samantha, our other guest, went to NYU as well.
Who?
Samantha, who also played a role in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., she's here. And you're both NYU grads, so that's pretty neat. Awesome. Nice connection.
Hello, fellow alum.
Yeah, so there's that type of training. But, once I got to L.A. and the closer we got to the scene, the fighting and everything, I started taking classes at a nearby gym, like that was like kickboxing and everything, because I didn't want to be completely like, what? I have to put my leg up and I punch with this fist. So I took a few classes and try to be ready, because I knew Ming-Na was gonna kick some serious butt, and I didn't want to go down like a wimp.
It's fair. Well, I would be intimidated.
Yeah. Now.
Oh yeah. She's beautiful. She's a wonderful person. But I was just like, yeah. I'm not gonna look like a complete punk.
Right. So. No one wants to look like a punk fighting Ming-Na. Okay.
Oh hell no. Hell no. Wasn't gonna be me anyway. So, yeah, I mean, she got me in the end, but. But or S.H.I.E.L.D. got me in the end, you know, and,
right.
Coulson and everything. But I was just kind of like, I'm going to go down looking good.
Exactly.
Now, were you a Marvel fan before you taped your episode?
No, I was not, but I've gotten into it. It's like, oh my gosh, like Captain America, Winter Soldier.
How good was that?
Oh my god. I can't even. Oh jeez. I'm like, you know, well, I shouldn't, you know, no spoilers. So I can't even say. But I'm too excited. I'm like, oh my gosh, I can't wait to see what happens. Okay, let me stop. But anyway, it was very exciting, and I can't wait to see more. I'm completely, like, just so many questions.
Yeah.
It's awesome. And just to see how, like, everything just ties into the episodic, the show that we see every week, you know, like, it doesn't really skip or miss a beat, like, what's going on in the movies and also what's going on with the show. So
yeah, it
just ties in.
They found a really beautiful balance, I think, after Winter Soldier, where it's dramatically affected the direction of the TV show, and putting it in, honestly, what I think is a more interesting arena, the fact that they are on the run, that they are dealing with the kinds of stakes that they didn't have to at the beginning when they had this massive organization behind them.
Oh my, yes, and then not only finding out that there's like a parallel organization that's like been there all along, and like, oh my, anyway.
In the age of terrorism, a sleeper cell is incredibly scary. So to have...
It is.
Yeah.
It is. That's the other thing, too, is kind of, I'm like, if there are any, like, sleeper organizations besides Hydra, whatever, I was just like, we really shouldn't be putting this type of stuff on television, because it's like giving those,
give people ideas.
those people who are, like, into this, like, you're giving them ideas, like, how to make a bomb, it's just kind of scary to watch it a little bit.
It's a lot of stuff that hits really close to home with just the way technology is evolving and everything like that. It makes the threat of Hydra in the film and in the show, it makes it more plausible.
Exactly, and thus scarier, because it doesn't seem all that far-fetched these days.
It doesn't.
To a certain extent, all of these things, I don't know what other things that, you know, terrorists, you know, cells and stuff like people are thinking or whatever. But it's like, it would kind of, I don't know how far advanced they are, but like, if we were giving them ideas it's the death of all of us. It's like,
right.
Oh my God. S.H.I.E.L.D. gave us this. It's just like, yeah, let's go ahead and do that.
Yeah, I'm really hoping that we don't have Al-Qaeda building massive helicarriers with robot guns.
That's no good.
I think as long as the ideas are stuff like gravitonium.
Right. Oh, my God.
Outlandish stuff like that.
Exactly.
Did you see that at the end of this episode?
Dude, we're totally going to talk about it. It's a big deal.
Graviton.
Well, no, since
every commercial break. because, you know, I saw it earlier than you guys.
Right.
So I, like, I'm, right. over here. It's always a big thing for me. Like, I don't want to, like, send spoiler tweets. But I'm just like, oh, my God, I can't, like,
you're
not write about this. So I always have
person.
To write something, like, holding my breath.
Everyone is grateful for you not tweeting.
Everybody who tweets from the East Coast Live, I have to do social media blackout on Twitter because I'm like, I can't look at my Twitter until
That's
I sit down and watch it.
That's just a way of life.
Exactly. No, I try not to, or else I just don't tweet at all because I'm like, I'm about to say something and people are going to be like, shut up, or
just,
whatever. So I
just turn off your phone for a little while. Well, since you're... Now you're a member of the Marvel family. Is Captain America your favorite Avenger, or do you have a different preference?
I'm kind of liking Captain America. Also, well, I mean, what I liked about him, because, of course, I was saying I didn't know much about the Marvel universe before, but it was kind of refreshing to see how Captain America, like, didn't use, like, all the heavy machinery. Like, all he used was the shield and, like, the beautiful brawn that he had going on. It was just lovely. But it was, you know, I was, that was kind of refreshing. And, you know, I mean, Anthony Mackie with the flying. And
he was really
and,
fantastic.
You know, like, you know, Scarlett Johansson, like, that woman holds a gun like somebody else's business. But it was nice to see that there was somebody out there doing good for the good of humanity, but also not going into the route of, like, just using the heavy machinery and the just, you know, more violence and stuff. So I like him for that.
I like him too.
And like I said, I'm kind of new to the whole universe and everything. But to see that he wasn't using all of that artillery and everything, I was just like, oh, like, everything was like a defense.
Right.
You know, he
values human life. He's not going to be overly violent.
I love that.
Yeah.
I love that. Yeah, so Captain America is my man.
Yeah, he's a good one. Pascal, I want to thank you so much for joining us and staying up late to be on our show. It's a real pleasure.
Thank you. The pleasure was mine. Thank you so much for having me. I appreciate it.
Absolutely.
Where can the people find you? Or do you have any upcoming projects you want to plug really quick?
Oh, well, I'm basically working on the East Coast. I just booked a show that I'm going to be doing in Connecticut, just something to keep me busy for the summer, the first half of the summer. And a little commercial that I just filmed last week. Other than that, like, no, I'm just waiting to ask to be asked to come back on the set. So at this point, I'm just biding my time.
Well, Coulson needs all the help he can get, so they got to get on
that.
Yeah. He's a dude, but he's doing really well. I mean, he's also somebody that I'm really looking out for, and, you know, just like our hero for the whole show. So,
great.
He's definitely somebody that I'm looking out for, and, you know, like, I'm just rooting for him all the way.
Great. Well, we will keep our eyes peeled. Thank you so much for joining us, the lovely Pascal
Thank
Armand.
Thank you, Pascal.
We're
Have a wonderful night.
We're going to move on.
Thank you so much, you guys.
All right. So really quickly, I'm just going to do our iTunes bit before we move on. You knew it was coming. Two quick shout-outs tonight. Shieldtastic, a review from BYYSD. Really enjoyed the podcast, review of the shows. Helped me consider theories connected to the show and the Marvel Universe. Matt's a great host, and his lady co-hosts are very refreshing and insightful and easy on the eyes, too.
Oh.
Thanks, guys. Keep it up. Is what he's saying is I'm not easy on the eyes, but I'm fine with that. Excellent. By Emmy Kent, 5 stars. Awesome podcast. I look forward to listening to this as soon as I finish watching the episode. I'm with Megan on Hail Coulson. It sounds better than Hail Hydra.
With two hands.
Yes.
Oh, no. That's a little too close.
Yeah.
Cheerleader. Yeah, we have to find out a hand signal of some kind.
I could do a double fist, like, in the air. Like, woo.
Yeah, exactly.
Very,
like,
he's a party guy. Just extend it the wrong way, and all of a sudden you're
Or it's like a folded arms, like a grumpy dad.
Or maybe it's like fix your tie.
Yeah, something like that. One more thing, Emmy Kent said. She said, one thing, Matt was wondering why Garrett would remove May's cuffs in last episode, her handcuffs. He didn't. Coulson did and used the cuffs to beat up Garrett.
Yeah, we were all wondering how May had gotten out of the handcuffs because it went by so quick.
It was so
fast.
I didn't
see that. I didn't actually see that
part. But you can
part.
See Coulson, like, grabbing them from somewhere. somewhere and bringing it down in like a hammer motion.
I don't remember him taking it off her. That's so funny. Well,
I just want to thank those folks for reaching out on iTunes. Just a reminder, it's the best way to support the show and everything we do here at AfterBuzz TV. We put out over 60 shows a week. It's a crazy amount of content. It's all free. We don't want your money. We just want you to help us out. Go rate, review the shows. It's how we're able to get great guests. It's how we're able to keep our doors open and our lights on, and we thank you for your support. Okay, so we're still dealing with all this great Hydra-y stuff. Mm-hmm. Garrett is evil and mustache twirly, and I never thought Bill Paxton, I've never seen him, A, in a role like this scenery-chewing bad guy role, and B, he just looks so strange with his hair plastered to his head like that.
It was very Jack Nicholson in like the Tim Burton Batman movie for
kind
a little
of,
bit.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Minus the creepy smile.
Exactly.
But both of them, I just buy it. So, like, if you told me three episodes ago these two are going to be evil, I would have said you're crazy. But the way it went, it just rings true to both characters. I love Evil Ward. I hope he doesn't flip back.
Yeah, a lot of people on the Reddit are agreeing with you. They're saying, you know, Evil Ward's so great. I hope he stays evil and becomes the big bad of the season, which I don't know if that's going to come to pass. But it's kind of, it's unlocked his inner charisma. The fact is, we've all felt, I think on some level, at some point, something just kind of off about him. Like, man, this guy seems kind of flat. Like,
he's got so much starch in his suit.
Yeah.
Right. That, like, you know, where are we going to find the vulnerability in him? And this is the way into his vulnerability. He's someone who is a double agent, who has been lying to all these people who call him friend. And he's got feelings for Sky that go against his orders. Mm-hmm. And when push comes to shove, he's going to have to make a major decision. And I feel like that's the best way to identify with him, because even when, you know, all this stuff is so out of our understanding, everyone has been faced with a hard choice at some point in their life. And also, just seeing him unencumbered from the lies, we get a sense of who he really is. And he's just this swaggering dick badass. You know, he I jumped out of a plane, saved their scientist. Yeah, I had a parachute, but I'm a liar.
No big deal.
I'm a liar, so.
I mean, that was fantastic, just walking through how this wasn't like a decision they made, like, we're writing episode 14 this week. What do you guys think? Should Ward be bad?
Right. Yeah.
Like, this was constructed, and it was interesting, I was reading an article, interview with Jeff Bell, one of the executive producers, and he was saying that, like, they didn't tell him.
No, they didn't.
While.
They called him in for a meeting, and he thought that they were going to kill him because all the main writers were there. So poor Brett Dalton is like dragging his feet to this meeting, thinking he's like,
this is the death meeting. Yes,
Charlie Brown heading.
And then they tell him, he's just like completely blown away. He's like, that's the best idea. Oh my gosh,
it's awesome. And he's a lot more attractive this way. I'm glad
to say.
Listen, it's the stubble and leather jacket. Leather jacket plus a 2-day beard makes any man 30% more attractive.
Well, here's the question.
Now he's a bad boy, too. We can change him if we love him enough.
Is it the scars? Do we need scars on our faces? Is that what Matt and I are missing?
No, might as well try. Doesn't hurt, right?
It's true.
Right, Matt, you just let it happen. Let it happen.
Agent Grant Ward of S.H.I.E.L.D. Agent Ward of S.H.I.E.L.D.
You know, none of our episodes have ever erupted into violence before. Zach, don't make me put you on timeout.
Yeah, Zach,
no podcast I've ever known that we've sat on the same side. It's, this is going to happen every time.
It's
clearly
so
we need
weird.
To separate you
it's
two.
It's so weird to be next to him.
I can give you guys a Sharpie. You can draw scars on each other.
Yay! Let's do that.
It's a little more safe, yeah.
Yes. Garrett reveals his sinister plan, which is to go to the fridge and break in and steal lots of cool S.H.I.E.L.D. stuff.
They're like kids in candy stores.
Well, he calls it the candy store.
Yeah, toy
the toy store.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Because it's packed full of goodies. Oh, great. We do have a Sharpie. We can mark each other up.
You'll have like Hydra symbols on your cheek.
Let's not do that. But yeah, they want to steal all the technology that they can while S.H.I.E.L.D. is in disarray. Their most secure facility is now completely insecure. So they land on the roof of this massive building out in the middle of the ocean. And the only way in is through the roof. These guys actually doing their jobs. These security guys are like, hey, we can't let you through without, you know, hands authorization. And Ward does the classic, well, she's going to be mad at you if you don't let us in. And he's like, you want me to call her? He's like, yeah, that's exactly what I want you to do.
I love that. I love when he said that. Yeah. I was like, yes.
Because that's what guards are supposed to do.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's something that kind of drives me crazy in most movies is that, like, it's like, these people would be fired.
Exactly. You're supposed to do your job. You're supposed to follow orders. And a lot of people in a lot of movies are like, oh, okay, let's go.
I don't want someone to be mad at me.
Did you guys ever see Monsters vs. Aliens? There was one of those guys, and he literally like hands them a gun. And was like, would you like a gun? Here's your security clearance pass.
Exactly. Here's your lanyard. We'll get into that later. But yeah. So they have this brilliant tactic where they have an attack chopper fire on themselves. So it's a Hydra attack chopper attacking Ward and Garrett out on this roof, and you know, making it really convincing that they are under attack.
Well, I don't think Ward was in on that either.
Oh, really?
No, he wasn't. He was like, a little heads up would have been nice.
Yeah.
Yeah, so he wasn't in on that. But that was smart. It was smart. It worked.
It was very smart. It got
Garrett
them through the door.
Garrett likes to keep people on their toes.
Yeah, exactly.
And then how casually, once they got into the elevator, he just lifts up two dual-wield pistols and just shoots them both in the head with no flinch, no recoil, no nothing, just like, blam. All right, you should have told me about that show. Jesus. I'm sorry, my gigantic dick is just not... I'm sorry, I just can't get over... I can't get over his whole... What was it? I'm everyone's type?
I'm everyone's type.
I'm everyone's type.
I'm like, oh, brother,
give me a break.
So smug.
Well, and it's interesting, too, just because when in that conversation with Raina, and she's like, a man like Coulson, he's a good man. Like, don't you owe him something? And he's like, yes, absolutely. But I owe Garrett everything. Mm-hmm. And so if he's being honest here, there's no going back.
What have we learned about Ward this season, right? He's someone who has this unquenchable anger left over from his childhood. He's someone who could have been... an incredibly dark person who could have been in an incredibly dark place, and he kind of is. The story we were given was that, Agent Garrett found him and brought him to S.H.I.E.L.D. and made him into the man that he is. Mm-hmm. We assumed that that meant, man of the people, man of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Somebody who wanted to protect other people.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. But it turns out he just wants to protect Hydra.
He also drops a hint that he may have had other identities in the past. Mm-hmm. He's like, this isn't the first time I've had my identity rewritten. So who knows who he was before he became... Like, Ward is just that name means nothing anymore.
Right.
It's just a blank piece of paper.
He's a ghost.
Yeah. And it also, Ward can be... To ward off or a ward of the state. I was thinking it meant kind of something similar to Shepherd, of like someone who takes care of people. Mm-hmm. But in any case, I may be wrong about that. Don't hate me.
you keep a ward. I can't remember the exact definition, but you're okay.
Well,
I know
somebody
what
who's
going to say,
ward
yes.
off evil.
Yeah,
right,
exactly.
Protect so the name even may have been by design. I want to talk about a moment in that conversation that he has with Skye where. She asks him who he wants to be, or like who he's going to be when he comes back. He says Tom Brady, and he gets off the phone with her, and Garrett's like, "What are you talking about? You hate the Patriots."
To win my heart, Ward. You're evil now.
Yeah. Wait, but what does he say in response? What does Ward say in response to that?
The Ward that she knows doesn't,
The Ward that she knows likes the Patriots. Mm-hmm. And some people on Reddit are taking that to believe, or taking that as Ward is actually going to be a good guy and he's doing a double blind right now, and that he is now a Patriot. Is that a huge stretch on the part of the internet or what?
Well, we were theorizing last week that this could very well be a double blind,
I know.
It could be a bluff,
but
something done
to
get on Garrett. Well, and especially with the shot at the end of the last episode where Garrett is, telling the same story that he told Coulson the episode before. And Ward's just like staring off and he can like barely hear Garrett. So a lot of people took that to mean that he wasn't actually with Hydra, or that he was only with Hydra to gain their trust and to hopefully, you know, defend the team.
Right. Mm. But now that I've seen him and Garrett together, it feels pretty convincing.
It does.
It's also that, like, if he was ever going to play for the S.H.I.E.L.D. team, stopping them from raiding the fridge and stealing, like, the gravitonium and all that, that would have been the time to stop it.
Like, when Garrett was ready to go, and then he totally was like, wait a second, there's something else, and blasts open the floor to reveal the gravitonium, he could have not done that. If he was really working for S.H.I.E.L.D.
I don't think that, Coulson would have been like, hey, if you guys go to the fridge, since that's where you're going, you should totally blast open that floor and unleash all of the people that we have locked up.
Yeah, I could have seen sacrificing, like, Hand as, like, just a chip that has to be played to gain their confidence.
Or like, even faking her death. Like, some people were thinking that it was
an icer
staged.
Well, but you look at the gun, and those were bullets.
He shot her multiple times.
He, like, shot her, and then he stood over her and fired two more into her skull.
Cold-blooded.
Yeah. I think it's safe to say that he's a Hydra agent.
Yeah.
I think so, too.
Now, in the chaos, Garrett releases a bunch of people from the fridge, among them Ian Quinn, but also this very tall, blonde gentleman who I don't believe we've met before.
No, we haven't.
But is featured, if not necessarily prominently, in the preview for next week. And we'll get more into that once we're in predictions and we're past the spoiler wall, because I don't want to talk about it for anyone who hasn't seen it.
It was like the only one that part of me was hoping that Neil Blomsky was going to, like, run out of one of those cages and go by. Because they make reference specifically that he's at the fridge.
Right.
That the Abomination is just at the fridge.
Oh my god!
That
would have
been amazing.
In theory, like, it's all connected. He's out in the world now to be used whenever they want.
Which, I mean, in an episode that also features Glenn Talbot, it would have been really, really, you know, nice to see more Hulk characters.
Which, for anyone at home that doesn't know, Glenn Talbot, who was played by Adrian Pastar in this episode, was he's a commander under General Ross, who in the comics eventually marries Betty Ross, who is
some variations of the comics.
I think that's the main one, that the main storyline. That's his.
Basically, he's an antagonist for Bruce Banner. That's the long and short of
it. He's a romantic rival, and they hate each other. And
no, he's a jerk with that mustache.
Which, like, you look at it, it is on him crooked. One half is pasted a little bit higher than the other half.
Aww.
It is clearly a fake mustache. I mean, that's what it is. It's fake. It's not a real mustache.
You seem a little upset about that.
I am upset because I like it when I don't see the seams in the reality of my favorite shows. And this exactly.
Oh, the more you know.
Yeah, the more you know. And I know that mustache is fake, and I wanted a real one in any case.
For me, it was just really weird seeing. Did he play Nick Petrelli?
He played, Nick Petrelli. It was Peter Petrelli Senator.
What was Senator Petrelli's
name? You worked on the show, Zach.
I thought it was Nick, but I don't remember. No, I don't remember Nicholas Peter's Petrelli. Brother's first name, because it's been a long time since I watched Heroes.
Even me, I haven't watched it.
Older brother
Nathan.
Petrelli.
Nathan.
See, I was
Petrelli.
Close. It started with an N.
Yeah.
It was just really weird to see Nathan Petrelli.
No comment.
Ooh. Everyone tweet Zach hate because he worked on Heroes, but he couldn't remember Nathan Petrelli. At Zach Wilson on Twitter.
Thanks,
but
Matt.
I just really wanted him to be like, Coulson, I'm on my way over, and then just jump up and fly out of the camera.
Yeah, that would have been interesting. Okay, so what else is going on here? They've got the 084 from the second episode. Blasting holes and everything. They got Ian Quinn, they got the gravitonium, which I don't think they realize is actually Dr. Hall sentient gravitonium.
Yee. Graviton!
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, way back when, we were like, that's going to come back at some point. Now we're seeing, again, it's all connected. Everything that was planted in the beginning of the season is starting to bear fruit. So I'm very, very excited to see where that goes. And Ward is given a mission. He's given an ultimatum. They've got this hard drive. Raina can't open it. She can't decrypt it. Sky has very cleverly programmed it so that only she can open it with her password. If anyone else tries, it will delete itself.
And not just a password. I mean, I imagine there's some like crazy level of encryption. Mm-hmm. I don't understand computer language. So.
That's okay. Yeah, just assume it's encryption. That's always a good call. Yeah. So he has been charged with. He has 24 hours to go in, seduce Sky, get the password, and get out. Otherwise, he has to cross off the entire team, bring Sky with him, and they will torture her until she gives up the password. Not good news.
Nope. Mm-hmm. And so it is very interesting because he has developed these feelings for Sky. You know, even Garrett's pointing it out. He's like, look, I get it. She's cute. So it does put him in a very interesting position. So even though it's pretty clear that he is Hydra and that he's been Hydra this whole time, it does beg the question, will he stay Hydra?
He could flip. I just think he hasn't been. Although I don't think he's going to torture Sky to get that password or get her in it. I think
you don't
he's
think
gonna...
Garrett's going to torture?
No, I think he's going to play the good guy card
to
get her to open it up. Like, that's why he's going to go back.
He does
say
he has a very persuasive personality.
Yeah, I think he just gets, because she still trusts him.
Well, I'm not saying Ward was going to torture her. I was going to say Garrett was going to torture her.
She doesn't trust Garrett because she knows.
Well, nobody's going to trust Garrett anymore. But,
right, he shot her. He had her shot.
I feel like the play is for Ward to just get Sky to unlock the hard drive.
Right. Well, that's what they want.
He doesn't want his cover to be blown at this point.
But he only has a day to do it. So by the end of next episode, more likely than not, our heroes will know that Ward is a traitor. A big, fat traitor.
Dun, dun, dun.
Okay.
He's not very fat. He's very fit.
He's very, very fit. Fine.
Very fit.
A big, brawny, muscly, handsome, well-built, in shape, live, interesting traitor.
What were we talking about?
Oh, can we pick apart one line that Garrett said to Ward? He said, don't forget what the assignment was and who gave it to you. So who is it?
Do you think it's Baron Von Strucker himself?
Yeah, I mean,
it's possible.
Von Strucker, Zemo, if he's coming.
Oh man, are we getting into Zemo territory?
I don't know. There's so many Hydra people.
That's
could
true.
Be.
Okay, but that is something that we should keep in mind as the season goes on. We gotta talk about Coulson. We're already halfway through the show, more than half. So Coulson is kind of grasping at straws here. His whole reality's been blown up. The thing that he has been fighting for, that he was brought back to life for, and it's falling down around him, and he's getting nothing but bad news. Mm-hmm. The worst of which, of course, is the continuing fallout from the revelation that May has been spying on him, and he finds out exactly why this episode. You know, Fury... we learn was not in charge of the Tahiti project, which you can speak to us a bit about. were you actually in charge of the Tahiti project?
Maybe.
Okay. you're remaining mum on the subject.
I'm gonna stay mum on that.
It's a magical place.
It's a magical place.
Right. So Fury was not in charge of it. So Fury tasked May with making sure that Coulson was not an instrument of Hydra, that he had not been brainwashed, that he had not been tampered with, that he was not going to go crazy. And, you know, to anyone who cares about him, Coulson's behavior seems a little off, okay?
He was very off-kilter this episode.
But you can't blame him. I mean, like we were saying, like his whole world is falling apart. And everything he knows is a lie now.
And he thinks that Fury is dead.
Well, it's a roller coaster for him because first he thinks he's dead, then he gets these coordinates and he's given hope, which is both a wonderful thing and a dangerous thing. And so then he, you know, hauls the team up to the middle of nowhere to stand.
Uses the last of their fuel.
to stand in the middle of like an empty snowfield to get access to Providence, and then to be told to his face, no, Fury is actually dead. And then to be taken aside and go, no, Fury's alive. But they can't know that.
Thank God. Like, yes. I was so worried that they were just going to keep playing the Fury is Dead card, even though the audience already knows.
Right.
I like this dynamic, though, because now Coulson, like, he's trying to be all on the up and up, and May's going to be super suspicious because she's going to know he's hiding something now.
Well, mm-hmm. And the important thing to pull from that was that now Garrett and Ward and everybody on their side still thinks that Fury's dead, because mm-hmm. that's exactly mm-hmm. what Sky told them, is that yeah. this mm-hmm. was a dead end in terms of trying to find Fury.
Right. But in terms of rebuilding trust, having a secret from the rest of the team is definitely detrimental to that cause. I love the moment where Coulson feels like maybe he's lost everything, and he kind of breaks down a bit mm-hmm. in that snowfield. A wonderful piece of acting from Clark Gregg.
That was the best scene, in my opinion, in the entire episode.
You could feel the frustration. Just that like... he's unable to do anything from there. If this didn't work, he's out. Like, he's out of ideas.
Well, they're dead, yeah. basically. Yeah. The plane's out of juice. Mm-hmm. It's not going to go anywhere. And the fact is, we've never seen Phil Coulson more vulnerable mm-hmm. than he is right now.
He needed to release all that. Like, mm-hmm. as you could see that he was on edge the entire time, and he needed it, and the right. team needed to see that as well. And then for him to be like, okay, got that all out
and
there.
And S.H.I.E.L.D. has come apart at the seams, mm-hmm. too, and he's the one keeping it together, especially, mm-hmm. they don't know it yet, but Han's dead, so he's the one keeping S.H.I.E.L.D. together. Mm-hmm. And the only thing he has to go on to keep himself from falling apart is the hope that Fury's alive. And there's really not a lot to really substantiate that hope. So, yeah, it's Coulson, seeing Coulson at the end of his rope, it really was.
It's heartbreaking.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's heartbreaking. He's in mourning. He's desperate. He doesn't have any answers.
I mean, since we first saw him in Iron Man, mm-hmm. this is everything to him.
He was the company man.
And he helped, in a sense, build it. I guess S.H.I.E.L.D.'s been going on way longer than him, but he helped make it what it is today.
Well, and he's always been cool as a cucumber under, like, any situation. Yep. It doesn't matter if a man in, like, you know, a giant metal suit is coming after him. It doesn't matter if he gets stabbed by Loki. He still has the presence of mind to shoot Loki and then give off a little zippy one-liner.
I love that. Yeah.
Oh, so that's what it does, huh?
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. I love that.
Yeah. Always a pleasure. So he throws his S.H.I.E.L.D. badge in frustration, and it is blasted out of the air by a robot gun, which thankfully does not shoot our heroes, and they enter the secret bunker known as Providence, home to Agent Koenig, played by the wonderful Patton Oswalt.
Yay!
Yeah! Oh, he was so good.
So great in this episode, and I hope that he sticks around. Nice dose of fun and comedy, and in a very different style than we get from, say, Fitzy mm-hmm. Or anyone else on the cast, so that was nice. Triplet is still hanging around, man. And Simmons fought for him. He's her responsibility.
Uh-huh.
And he asked for a bunk on the bus. Whose bunk is he sharing? But poor Fitzy, man, he just cannot own up to his feelings and ask her out already. He knows he's jealous. Mm-hmm. He knows he's jealous. He doesn't want things to change, but they're going to change if he doesn't do anything
exactly.
about it.
It's a little too late for that.
It is, as Simon says, yeah.
That shot with him in the box where he's just standing there holding the box.
Oh, he's so sad and pathetic.
He's like a little puppy.
It's a rule that everyone should follow. If you feel something, say something. Period. Mm-hmm. Don't waste time. Mm-hmm. And he's wasting time when there might not even be that much time left.
Exactly.
They could all be dead. And he is not telling Simmons how it feels. Exactly. Aww. Thank you, studio audience. Just, you gotta own up and you gotta do it. And he refuses. Yeah. And Triplet is tall and well built. And very, very smooth.
Yeah, a lot of fans are really liking him, the idea of him being an addition to the team.
I'd be down. If Ward is forever evil, I'd be down with a little injection of Triplet.
I would too.
I think so would Simmons.
Can we? There.
I went there. I set up shop. I broke ground on a business, and it's opening in the spring.
I wish we had a drum set because there we go.
Do we have that on the board?
The sound.
Do we have a rim shot? No, no rim no. shot. That's okay.
That's a negative. We have to work with what we got. It's okay.
Yes. So
he.
Yeah, that's the same.
Noisemaker is not the same.
I mean, Trip would be a great replacement. Yes. They need a specialist. Yeah. If they're going to continue with the standard format of the team.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And he fits in that dynamic. Like, there's enough going on there that I think if we develop his backstory, he'll be an interesting character.
Yeah, I want to learn more about him, where it comes from. You know, who are his people? I want to know.
There's hopes and dreams. Yeah.
What are the other?
What are his likes? What is his dislikes? Does he like long walks on
what
the
does
beach?
He like to
Megan,
eat?
Chill.
He's like running her finger on the
Other salient points. Coulson tasks Sky with removing any trace of everyone on the team from the internet, period, which is a big deal. It's a button you can't press twice where you technically no longer exist.
Well, and that was something we were really concerned about, too, at the end of the last episode, because all of S.H.I.E.L.D.'s information was leaked onto the internet.
Right. Mm-hmm.
You know, all of the file on Sky, you know, all of the stuff on Coulson, everything that S.H.I.E.L.D. has is public domain.
I was expecting to get some kind of pickup on Sky's origins little subplot, just from the sheer fact that she's running into all this information on the web, maybe she would find a new piece of it. Or even just concern that if she no longer exists, then how will she ever find her origins? I was hoping for something.
I wonder how much of, like, if there is anything that didn't get out, like the stuff that's like only level 8 access, if that's still...
Well, theoretically, like, the location of Provenance. Because that was a secret base.
Well, but even S.H.I.E.L.D. people didn't know, because it's like it's like well established in like the Marvel universe that Fury has all these random bases that nobody knows about. We see one in Captain America when they're soldier, like they go to that one that's like
when he's
just
dead,
got
quote
all
unquote,
these dead drop places that he just installs. How many Agent Koenigs or similar are just scattered, living alone, playing Call of Duty?
It seemed like a relatively cozy spot. I'm not going to knock it, okay? Yes, the cafeteria was kind of dorm-esque. We're not going to say it isn't. But I'm sure his living quarters are very cozy.
Do you guys think that is Providence our new home base
for the series
going forward?
I feel like they're introducing it as a potential home base.
The way just the shot choice, like as they went through, that was very much like an introduction.
It's like a welcome to
the cafeteria. That is, we built a standing set in our studio, and it's going to be there for 2 seasons at minimum.
Right, which hopefully means we're going to get way more Patton Oswalt. But, you know, as S.H.I.E.L.D. continues to fall down around itself and we, you know, lose more and more of the organization, you know, we have this whole discussion, right? You know, we're not agents of nothing. We are agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Even if other people have given up on S.H.I.E.L.D., we will be, you know, that S.H.I.E.L.D., basically.
Yeah, that still carries weight.
Exactly, that still carries weight. So if the rest of S.H.I.E.L.D. disbands, I imagine that Phil will continue to operate out of this, out of Providence, out of this base, and continue to help try to save the planet. That's what I'd like, anyway.
With Nick Fury running around and
being not dead.
although I did think it was funny, someone on the subreddit mentioned that they should have thrown up a title card that said "Agents of Nothing" at the top of the show.
And that agents really of funny. Like question mark dot dot dot.
No, agents out of n dot o dot t dot h dot I dot n dot g dot.
Sure that someone could come up with an amazing acronym.
Yeah.
Well, actually, can I bring up something that we sort of skipped over a little bit earlier?
Yeah, please.
When Garrett is putting on his shirt, like he's getting changed, we see some sort of metal thing, like
weird
on his
metal
side.
Plating.
Right.
Yeah,
and like on his back.
That. Yeah.
Like, so is he like part Deathlok? Like, is this how like he got the technology, you know, to send Deathlok all this stuff? Is like he needs it himself for one or two of his injuries? What happened there?
I mean, he's not a Deathlok necessarily, but he's probably enhanced.
Or is maybe he's got like the centipede, like the all the
just here, yeah.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I mean, maybe that's why he started doing all of these things, like all the crazy experiments and the Deathlock program.
Yeah, he said he saw, you know, he felt the wind changing and he decided to swing his sails. Maybe it was a danger like to his life, like you know, Hydra was doing stuff that could possibly prolong his life for something that he had going on, and so he's like, okay, I'm going with Hydra, and maybe that's why he's so interested in the GH-325, because whatever he's got, whatever caused that, is actually killing him.
I like this theory. I like this theory a lot.
Using that.
Got the old noodle. Big fan. All right. Anything else we want to discuss? I feel like we covered a lot of it.
Everything, yeah.
Okay. Well, then let's talk to you, Samantha, about your time on the show. You were lucky enough to be in two episodes this year.
Mm-hmm.
So how did you wind up with the role? You auditioned?
I did. Yes, I did audition. That was because I've the casting office, they've actually brought me in for the Avengers, actually. And,
oh, wow.
Yeah. And they've cast me in other shows that they've done. So. They are fans, and they brought me in, and it was really easy. Because it's so secretive, I didn't get the sides anytime before. Like, I literally went there, they handed me what I was going to say, and I did it, and then the next day they're like, so you want to work on your French Polynesian accent? I'm like, yes, I would. And they were very, very secretive. I didn't know that I was going to come back. I had an inkling. I mean, the way it was all set up, you have to address what all that
was about.
Yeah,
you have to go there.
Exactly. Yeah. So I was very, very excited about that. And everyone on set was so cool. I mean, Clark, amazing. He made it feel so comfortable. I mean, it was easy for him. All he had to do was lie there.
Right.
And for the research, that was really amazing for me because I just went and got a bunch of massages.
Ooh. Yeah.
I like
how dedicated you are.
Oh, it's totally a tax write-off. I'm like, okay. And then every day getting massages, got my nails done too, because I'm like, it's gonna get in the shot,
it's
right?
A hard job, but someone's got to do it, right?
You know, I'll take one for the team. But it's really awesome. Then I got to, in the next episode or the other episode I was in, I got to work with Ron Glass, and he was really great. And I mean, they kind of made it sound that maybe he might come back, but I'm not, I don't know.
That was actually something that I was wondering, because they brought it up in this episode. We don't know how much, you know, Coulson's mind has been altered by what happened. So is there a possibility that Karine could come back?
There's always a possibility for anything, right?
Right.
Anything is possible.
Anything is possible.
When they brought you in, how did the directing go? Like, did they tell you, like, oh, you're playing this up like this is the best vacation ever? Or did they want you to play it like it's a little bit more eerie, like something's not quite right here?
Oh, no. They wanted to make sure that it was the best thing ever for him. Like, this is the happiest place on earth. That first episode, I actually got had the pleasure of working with Jonathan Frakes, who played Riker on Star Trek.
Oh yeah. My gosh, I love him.
Yeah.
He's awesome.
So he was really cool, but he kind of just let us do our own thing, but overall just make it feel like this warm, magical place and make him feel like this is the best place on Earth. So that was cool. The main direction for that. And you never know. Like, again, they said it's a magical place. And
yeah,
I need to explain more. And they keep putting pictures of Tahiti all over the place. So I don't know. It's got to mean something,
it's
right?
It's got to mean something.
Like they said,
that's
it's all
true.
Connected.
All the windows in Providence?
Oh.
Yeah, that looks like tropical.
Like Tahiti.
They said that it changes all the time, but it was definitely a tropical setting when they came in this time.
Interesting. Mm-hmm. And it makes sense then that would be the base that he would want Coulson to come to. Because it's got the answers for when he really needs them.
Mm-hmm. And we never really did find out what Tahiti stood for, so.
That's true.
Mm-hmm. So many questions.
So you've done this show, you've done work on a few other TV shows. Would you consider this show the career highlight so far, or what has been your favorite acting experience?
This was definitely one of the highlights. Another highlight was when I got to work on House. That was amazing, like right before the show ended. So that was really cool because I was a guest star on that, where I was throughout the entire episode and basically followed my journey while my son in this episode was dying. Or,
oh, man.
Yeah.
Intense.
Yeah, and I look so young, too. I was like, you want me to play 30 through to a 15-year-old boy? Okay, sure. I'm sure the audience will buy that. Yeah. Well, yeah.
You've also been on Criminal Minds. How was that? One of our producers, Marissa, is a huge Criminal Minds fan.
That was actually the very first television show that I had booked when I came out here. So that was awesome. I just was in my zone, and I remember Shamar Moore when he was sitting across from me when I cried the first time. He's like, okay. He talked to me later, and he's like, when you cried the second time, I was like, okay. She got lucky. When you cried the third time, all right, this girl knows what she's doing. So, yeah, so that was an amazing experience. And then I just recently shot one of my other favorite shows, Castle, which is going to be coming out April 28th. And that show I just love. I love the humor in it. I love the dynamic between the two characters. But yes, this is going back to the original question, though. Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. is amazing. Amazing. I love just, because I was kind of in the Marvel world, but now I'm getting more into it.
Right.
I've watched all the episodes. I've loved Captain America, as we mentioned earlier, and I had to rewatch the Avengers right before I did that. So I was like, okay, I know who's who now. Okay. So it was awesome.
Cool. Well, so you've been doing all this. You've got Castle coming up. Is there anything else coming up in the future?
There is, actually. I mean, I have a group of friends and I, we are actually developing an independent film. So that follow me on Twitter, and then you'll get more information on that, which is at Escaterin. So
yeah, in terms of, like, now that you've been on television, and obviously you have a good theatrical background, and you've done a lot of independent work. Do you have a preference, like, in terms of, like, being on network television or doing kind of the more independent stuff?
Ooh, that's, I mean, they both have their things. I mean, with independent, it's nice because you have more time, which I love, because I'm a theater baby as well. As I said earlier, I went to NYU, so I was trained in theater, and you get more time with everything, and you get to really become, like, not just become, but you get to live and do a lot more research and just play with that. Whereas in TV, it happens so quickly.
Sure.
You can find out the day before that you are in the next episode.
Right. You get your sides, you prep, you shoot, you're out.
Exactly. So you make your choices, but you don't necessarily get this chance to, like, really
to live in that person.
Exactly. So, I mean, I mean, that's why I loved House so much, because I got to shoot that for 2 weeks and just really become this girl and had a lot of fun with it. So there are ups and downs to it. I mean, it's quick and easy. That's nice. I mean, because theater, you're in it for a really long time. But there are, like I said, pros and cons.
Great.
Yeah.
Well, I want to thank you for joining us on the show. It's been a real pleasure talking to you. Unfortunately, we are low in time, so we got to move into predictions.
Yeah, let's do it.
AfterBuzz TV predictions.
All right, folks. Now, and I want to hear your predictions too, of course, Samantha. So, what's going on next week, guys? We've got a big blonde telekinetic male out on the wilderness. We've got Gravitonium in the wrong hands. Okay. We've got Koenig still in the mix. We've got Ward in and amongst our friends, and he's bad. What's happening?
So much crazy.
Just from the preview, it looked like his cover's blown. It looks like Skye finds out, and that's a lot to take in. That's definitely
something. She finds out, and then she's going to get locked in a closet or something.
She should find out, and she should beat the crap out of him.
I would really like to see that.
I'm not saying you lied to me.
We would love to see that, wouldn't we, Lee?
Won't get that, but at first she's going to be like, let me out of here, you crazy. Yeah. See, here's my thing with the Gravitonium. I don't think we're gonna see it again in full until I'm thinking later season on. Finale.
Yeah.
And at that, like, right as, like, Garrett and everybody's gonna, they're like, yeah, we're gonna unleash this, and then Graviton's gonna pop. Professor, what's his name?
Dr. Hall.
Thank you, Dr. Hall. He's gonna pop out of there as Graviton in all his, like, silvery glory or whatever, and just kill them. He's gonna kill him on the spot. Like, that's when Garrett's gonna be dead.
I like that prediction, but I'm gonna say push it back an episode or two. I'm gonna say, like, if that happens, it's the end of the second to last episode or the third to last episode.
Penultimate.
Giving us some time to have S.H.I.E.L.D. have to deal with Graviton and have to figure out how to fight him.
All right.
Yeah. But I do love that prediction. I want to know what's up with our telekinetic giant dude.
He's very tall.
Very tall.
he's a scary looking man.
Scary too.
I mean, he's scary enough that they had to lock him in the fridge.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, not a fan of that. I still think Reyna's going to turn on Hydra.
I think so, too. Yeah, I get that, because she just seemed so betrayed and so hurt by that. So I can definitely see her.
So she's going to take her money. She's going to, you know, she's going to mess up their stuff and then leave.
And also, I think, maybe take all the blood, the samples. And
I'd like to see
that. Yeah, because, I mean, she's the only one. Well, not the only one, but she has full access to it right now. So I can definitely see her.
Once they get through the encryption, because the hard drive's still encrypted.
Right.
Mm-hmm. I'm standing by my assertion that Garrett's dying and that the whole reasoning behind this is that he wants to know what brought Coulson back to life so that he can use it on himself.
Great.
I like that a lot.
All right. I buy that.
Can I throw out, because I'm just filling in this week, I have an insane theory.
Okay,
I'd love to share
because
with you guys.
You're here this week and only this week. Let's do it.
All right, I'm just gonna blow through it. I think that because there was a lot of hints that the blue dude is a Kree.
Yes, yeah. Which is what I believe.
Yeah, and then it was kind of dropped on the carpet, but maybe not. There was a little bit of backtracking. There was a video leak from PaleyFest where I think it was Chloe Bennett was "Oh, it's a Kree."
No, that's her guessing. That Kristen and I interviewed her, and she's like, I think it's a Kree.
There's a clip where she says it with a bit of authority. But I'm just, it is what it is.
She was wearing she was wearing blue because she's like, I think it's a Kree, that's why I'm wearing blue.
Yeah. But anyway, so off of that theory.
Off of that.
He's like, yeah, whatever.
Theory, I think Skye is going to be Miss Marvel.
A lot of people are saying this.
I know,
but
I'm going to take it a step further.
Explain
and say
why.
Well, if they Miss Marvel is part Kree.
Yeah.
That's where her powers come from. She is part Kree, and so if we've taken pieces of Kree and put it into her, it's a different origin than we get in the classic 616 standard stories. But they're changing all kinds of stuff here. But I think my step further is that Coulson is actually Captain Marvel, Marvel.
Mm-hmm. What?
You think he's going to be Captain Mar-Vell because he's got all the Kree blood in him?
Well, there's a storyline with the Kree where Captain Mar-Vell hides as Dr. Phil Lawson on Earth, and he looks like a human.
I've read this, and I didn't even think about this.
Coulson's memories, because they're messing with his brain in the room there. Mm-hmm. I think they mapped his mind or brain in some combination into Captain Mar-Vell, and so that's going to lead us through that, and that's going to bring the Kree into this whole crazy story.
I don't know.
You just blew my mind right now, man.
People are going to need a week to decompress.
Captain Mar-Vell is also a mentor of sorts to Miss Marvel, Carol Danvers. We also don't know Skye's real name. It could be Carol Danvers. I'd be ashamed to lose her as a fighter pilot. Unless May is her mother, then you get the fighter pilot backstory.
Oh my gosh! Oh my gosh!
And that leads into an Avengers 3 if it's Skrulls.
He's got this so planned out.
I thought a lot about
this. Please, no. Skrulls aren't until Avengers 4 because we still have the Infinity Gauntlet in Avengers 3.
I know everybody thinks it's going to be Infinity Gauntlet in Avengers 3. I think small storyline, Secret Invasion.
I'm just picturing a wall in your apartment with all these strings. It's all connected.
All right, people, settle. Zach Wilson, where can the people find you?
You guys can find me on Twitter at @ZachWilson, and also here at AfterBuzz on Grimm Resurrection and Archer season finale coming up next week.
All right, Megan Salinas.
You can find me on Twitter at @TheMenguin. That's @TheMenguin. Special shout out to KristenCarol13 that you can follow on Twitter. That's @KristenCarol13. @JayAzuri and @PascalArmand for joining us tonight.
Yes, and Samantha, you said it before. Can you spell out your Twitter handle?
Absolutely. You can follow me at @Escutaran. It's @SCUTARAN.
Okay, and you can follow me on Twitter at @MattLieberman, @MattLieberman. You can find all my videos on my YouTube channel, youtube.com/MatthewDLieberman, for SourceFed, AfterBuzz TV, and lots of sketches. I want to thank everyone for joining us here tonight. We will be back next week. Have a good night.
From executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network. To watch or listen to other After shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Buzz you later!
The views expressed herein are those of the host only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.
Thank you for watching AfterBuzz TV on YouTube. For more of your favorite after shows and interviews, subscribe to our channel here. And be sure to share your opinion on the episode in the comment section below here. We'd love to see what you guys are buzzing about. Thanks again. Buzz you later.